Here we have a real nice mule deer that we're going to be measuring on a method form 18NT for a non-typical. The first thing you want to do when you're measuring any antler game is first to establish the top of your main beam and actually which point is going to be your main beam. I've already had a little bit of time to map this particular antlers out and mark off what's going to be my main beam. I've marked it off with some masking tape here. That's a little trick that I like to use, and a lot of other measurers do as well. It's real handy just to keep it straight when you're measuring and help you mark off what's going to be your main beam, so then you can go through and mark off what's going to be typical. But the first thing that I've done here is I'm using some welder's chalk or some soapstone and marking off the top of the main beam and where I'm going to start my measurements for each of the typical tines and some of the non-typical tines. The chalk lines here are a little bit thicker than I would normally make them. I want to make them show up really well here so you guys can see them. It's a nice illustration for you. But here is the top of the main beam, starting off with the T2, and here's the top of the main beam where my T4 is going to be measured back to. But since I've already got this mapped out pretty well, I'm going to go ahead and start just measuring this so you guys can get a nice illustration of how this is done. Whenever you're taking the main beam measurement, you want to use your cable so that you can get accurate measurement of the main beam. When you're starting your measurement, you want to be just above the eye socket here and make sure that you're staying in the center of the main beam the whole way through the measurement and following the outside curve of the antler. This is where you're going to get your largest measurement. And in SCI's scoring system, we're always going to try to give credit to the animal, and that's how you're going to yield your largest measurement, which is by finding the outside curve and staying through the center of that all the way to the tip. Once you get to the tip, you want to use your alligator clip to mark off where you ended your measurement. Just like so. Then you have your measurement there. You can lay this down on a piece of, or on your measuring tape. Usually you might have your cloth measuring tape taped down to the table if you're going to be taking a lot of measurements, or you can just lay it down and measure that like so. But once you've got your main beam measurement, the next step is just to go through and start measuring all of your typical tines. This particular set of antlers is unique in the sense that it has no brow tines, which is we're going to come across when we get to our circumferences. But for recording the length of the typical tines, you're just going to be marking off, you're putting a dash on the score sheet where the T1 is. So you're not going to get a measurement for your typical, for your T1. Next, moving to the T2 and the T3. In a mule deer, it's typical for the T2 and the T3 to fork. When you're measuring this and deciding which is going to be your T2 and which is going to be your T3, your T2 is usually the one that forks backward. And you're always going to want to measure it as if the T3 is the one that is forking off of your T2 and not the other way around. This is regardless of the growth pattern, the T2 always needs to be the one in the back, and it's typically going to end up being your larger one anyways. But if you have something that's a little bit uncharacteristic to this particular species where your T3 is a little bit longer, you're still going to be marking the T3 off as if it grew off of the T2. So now I'm going to take my SCI cloth measuring tape and measure this T2 here, starting off where I have my chalk line, where I've already marked this off, following the outside curve again, going up all the way up to the tip of this tine to get my true measurement. For this particular tine, it was 15 1/8. When we're dealing with antler game, particularly this particular method, it's always going to be recorded in eighths. It's not going to be recorded in half inches or a quarter. It's always recorded in eighths. You're never going to reduce your fractions. It's always going to be either 1/8 of an inch or 2/8 of an inch, and not 1/4. The next, we're going to go and move to our T3 here, measure this. I've already got it marked off here real nice, starting at my chalk line, following the outside curve here, all the way to the tip. Now I've got my measurement. As you can see, I'm disregarding any of the non-typical points here because I first want to get the measurements of all my typical tines. This is going to be the way that you can keep it straight in your mind easiest and help keep track of what you've measured and what you haven't. So that's how I always like to do it, especially when you get into stuff that's really complex and non-typical. It'll just be much easier to follow. Again, we're going to follow that same strategy, hitting the outside curve of this tine on the T4 and getting that measurement. Normally I'd be recording these measurements or having someone record them for me, but I've already had this particular set of antlers scored up, so I'm just going through and doing the demonstrations on how you go and measure this particular mule deer. Next, now that I've got all my typical tines measured, I'm going to come back and measure my non-typical points. This particular one is not going to qualify. It does not meet our 1-inch rule, which requires that a tine must be at least 1 inch long and no wider than it is long at any place past 1 inch. So this tine does not meet that rule and it will not count in the overall score. So the first non-typical point and the only non-typical point on this side is going to be this tine that's growing off of the T3. And in the SCI scoring system, we allow you to take the tine measurement from either the inside or the outside of the tine in order to obtain the largest measurement. And from here, you're obviously going to get a much larger measurement by measuring it from this side here. It's where you're going to hit the outside curve and obtain the largest measurement. So that's where we're going to start. I've already got it marked off here. Staying in the center, you want to make sure you stay in the center of the tine for all of your measurements. We got 4 7/8. And that's going to take care of all of our tine measurements. So next I'm going to start with the circumference measurements. The way I like to measure this when I do antler game is I take all the tine measurements and then I come back and do the circumference measurements on one side. So for this particular set, I'm measuring the right side first and then I'll move to the left side and measure everything on the left side. This is where the not having a brow tine is going to come into play for this set of antlers. When normally you'd have a C1 circumference in between the burr and your T1. With no T1, your first circumference and second circumference are going to be at the same location, and you're going to be taking the smallest circumference in between the burr and your T2, and you're going to record that measurement twice. SCI records the smallest circumference versus taking the largest circumference in between the tine locations, and we do that in order to obtain an accurate measurement each and every time. As you can see, this particular set of antlers has some bumps and ridges down here at the bottom. If we were taking our largest circumference, a lot of measures would be inclined to go over some of these bumps here and these ridges that really don't give a true representation of what the growth of the main beam really is. So we use the small circumference in order to obtain that. And when you see a lot of knobs and ridges, sometimes your cable might be the best tool to use in order to get in between them and take your circumference. You can do it like so. But here, your smallest circumference is going to be up closer towards your T2, just like that. And again, you can use your alligator clip to help you get this measurement. Or you can always use your cloth measuring tape, which I prefer for my circumferences if I'm able to use it. It'll be 3 6/8 for the C1 and the C2. Next, your C3 is going to be taken right underneath where the T2 and the T3 fork, and this is going to be taken right here at the smallest point in between the top of the main beam and below the fork here. You're going to want to check in a couple different locations just to see where the smallest circumference is going to be to make sure that you are recording your circumferences accurately. This one's going to get 3-3 for the C3 circumference. And then our last circumference here is going to be in between our T3 and our T4. It's going to get 3-5 for the fourth circumference. But as you can see, that's the way that you go through and you measure all of your typical tines, your non-typical tines, and then you get your circumference measurements. I do want to point out here on the left side, there's a real nice example of a main beam that splits, and so you guys can see it. I've marked off this one here below as my main beam so that I can count this one here as a non-typical point. This would be a non-typical point because it's not in a typical location for a mule deer, which can only consist of a maximum of 4 typical tines, and to where it doesn't have a brow tine, a T2, a T3, and a T4, this is in a non-typical location, so we've got to count it as a non-typical point. By calling this here our main beam, which it is if you can see here, it's got some primary blood lines that are running to it and not going up to this point here. This is our primary growth and it continues throughout such. So we're going to call this our main beam and be measuring this tine off the top of it here. Other than that, this left side is going to be measured exactly the same way as we did our right side. And the only other measurement we have left to get would be our inside span. The inside span is always taken at the widest point on the inside of the main beams. You're not going to be taking it at the top of the main beams or at the bottom. It's going to be on the inside in the center of the main beams here. And you can take your measuring tape, make sure that you have a tight tape the whole way through and that you're maintaining a angle which is perpendicular to the center axis of the skull. And finding the widest point in there, you want to check to see where the widest point is actually going to be. And that's going to be right there. And it's going to be 18 6/8. But that wraps it up for our non-typical mule deer.